Hey fellas, and welcome to Introducing Tokyo Mirage Sessions Sharp FE. Now, I don't know if it's sharp or hash or pound FE, but I have seen it written as sharp, which would make sense because, I don't know, there's some music references in this game, so I could certainly see it officially being sharp. Now, you may have heard of this game as being the cross between Shin Megami Tensei and Fire Emblem. It is indeed, I believe, I've heard, it is co-developed by the teams that made Shin Megami Tensei and Fire Emblem. And you may notice that FE, you know, are the initials of Fire Emblem, and Tokyo Mirage Sessions is SMT, Shin Megami Tensei, backward. So, I don't know if that's intentional, the SMT backward part. But anyway, let's jump right into it. What is this game? From what I have played so far, and this might just be because I am not as big a Fire Emblem fan as I am a Shin Megami Tensei fan, but from what I've played so far, this game appears to be 90% Shin Megami Tensei, specifically the Persona area of that, then 10% Fire Emblem. So what it is it looks a lot like Persona, except instead of a Japanese schoolboy, you know, for these parts, you are someone who is training to become an idol, but you are, you know, a Japanese idol. If you don't know about Japanese idols, well, we don't need to get into that. Just know that this game has a lot of waifus in it, let me put it that way. So speaking of waifus, this is a Wii U game, and on the gamepad here, I've gotten a text message from my waifu, Tsubasa Oribe. So let's see what she says. She says, "How many people has Mr. Horinozawa kidnapped? We have to save Miss Maiko and everybody else." So like I was saying about this game being a lot like Persona, it's very much like Persona 4, where what's happening is Tsubasa is a Japanese idol in training. You are kind of also an idol, just because it happens to go right along with the Mirage Masters, which are basically Persona users. So very much like how Persona 3 had the Seas, which was just a front for shadow hunting, this game has this idol studio that is a front for Mirage hunting. Now, as you can see, this menu is fantastic. This is an Atlus game as far as, you know, the menus and everything goes. I talk about it a lot, just how great this game's all Atlus games menus look. So let's take a look at our cast of characters here, because that's an important thing. And as far as the whole idol thing goes, what it means is that there's a lot of emphasis on the idea of performing. And so, you know, you got your skills and items, but like your equipment is called wardrobe. Your status screen, you're looking at your artists. Casting is what they call setting up what characters are going to be used in battle. They're pretty dedicated to that. So here are our characters. We've got here's our main character. This is Itsuki. This is you, essentially, and your guy, your Mirage, Kromu, this is his, and, you know, it's kind of like a Persona. He's more like the other characters of Persona games, where he's only got the one, and everybody's only got the one. This is my waifu, Tsubasa. She has, Seida. She's kind of an all-around character, it seems, you know, a little bit more magic than strength, but, you know, we'll get to Kiri. I guess she's more of a white mage, you could say, judging by her skills, but anyway, we'll get to that, because Kiri is a lot more magic-focused. Here's Toma. He's kind of he's sort of your Yosuke character, but he's more like Akihiko, I guess you could say. I'm sorry if you guys haven't played Persona and you have no idea what I'm talking about, but he's kind of like your Akihiko in that he's very strength focused, and also when you start the game out, instead of it being like like Persona 4, where Yosuke is kind of a buffoon, or like in Persona 3, how Junpei is kind of a buffoon, he's like the Akihiko in that he's the guy who's been doing this for a while. Even though he's your friend and you've known him, you didn't know this side of things, where he's been this secret Mirage Master, and he's been fighting Mirages. Because it's weird, you know, he hasn't told you that. So this is Kiria. She is a... she is actually a longtime idol. She is a very famous person, but she has now joined your group. And as you can see by her stats, she is much more the actual magic user, which is why, you know, I thought Tsubasa is more of an all-around character. Even though she is a little bit more magic-focused, Kiria is definitely your actual mage. Then these other characters are not yet... but perhaps later, not people who are who actually fight. So we've got Maiko. She's our she's the president of the front for the Mirage fighting. So, you know, she's kind of our manager. Barry Goodman is the very American man in the game who, he's your trainer, your personal trainer. Tiki is fantastic. This is a great character. So Tiki is a Hatsune Miku style virtual idol, right? She is a virtual idol, I already said it, but it turns out that she's actually one of these Mirages, but they've just kind of used that to make her a virtual idol. She's a real person inside the Mirage world. It's great. Anyway, then we can hop over to the other style menu, where you see these gorgeously drawn bios for the characters. Excuse me, I'm hiccuping from this Mountain Dew Pitch Black. So we get things like, you know, their data and biography. But also, what I really like is you get their signature. Again, this is very much about, like, famous, you know, becoming famous people. And so the signatures are real important, and it actually comes into play in a really cool way in a little bit. But I love these drawings. I love this kind of stuff. I mean, these are the kinds of details that are the reason I love JRPGs so much, is just all this good fan service and the fact that, like, in only a Japanese game will they list the bust, waist, and hip measurements of the characters, you know, like, and then immeasurable for Barry. That's also a very American looking signature. I really love this character. There's a very interesting thing with this character that I'll get into maybe in a little bit. There's Tiki. Okay, so let's get into the actual game here. What is unlike Persona is, and more like regular Shin Megami Tensei games, is that there isn't like a time mechanic, right? Instead, the game just progresses as a normal JRPG progresses. You know, things happen one at a time, one chapter at a time, and you don't have a time limit, and you don't have to spend your days in certain ways. You just do everything, and then you go do the main mission and all that kind of stuff. You know, however much you want to do. Anyway, so here is our entrance to the Idolosphere. Or Idolosphere, I don't know. This is the current dungeon that I just got to, and oh, I forgot to heal my party. So, let me show you. That's actually kind of an important thing. There are vending machines all over the place, and you may have noticed that the character's luck stat was not a 1 out of 100, like other games, like a lot of RPGs. It was instead a low to high rating. And it's interesting because you heal your party by going to vending machines and, like, drinking the things, and I happen to know Citrusana juice Tsubasa really likes. So I drink this, and it heals the entire party, like visiting an inn, but then because it was that specific drink that Tsubasa really likes, her luck gets a bonus until next time I heal the party. And you can only have one character at a time, but that's how that works. And I like it. I like this mechanic so far, but I would really like to have a way to permanently increase my character's luck. I'm not sure if that is going to be a thing that I can do or not. I have not figured that out yet necessarily. Anyway, let's go back in. And let's get to the actual gameplay, because now I've been telling you guys a lot about the characters and such of this game so far, but I haven't shown you the actual battle system or what the real meat and potatoes of the game is besides the day-to-day run around, do the normal JRPG kind of stuff. So here these guys pop up, you hit them, it kind of staggers them, which either lets you get away without having to deal with battles, or if it lets you get the first strike if you run into them. So on top there you see the turn order. It's kind of Fire Emblem-y. We get this bonus turn because I hit them with the sword successfully. It's this guy. Now this is very Persona-like. If you go over a guy, you get the status of them. So this guy's weak to ice, axes, and swords. Light. None of which Tsubasa has. So I'm just gonna do a regular attack and not worry about it. But then we're gonna get over to Itsuki, and here is how this game's weakness mechanic works. So he was weak to swords, which this guy has. Now, when I do this, it's gonna do a combo. He's gonna hit, and then Tsubasa's gonna go, awesome, I'm gonna hit him with my thing in a combo. Why did that happen? That is how this game's weakness mechanic works, and I will show you how that works, because it is really, really cool. Once again, fucking Shin Megami Tensei has managed to take their formula of all the enemies have these weaknesses and these resistances, and if you exploit the weaknesses, you get some kind of bonus. They've managed to take that and again, like, reiterate on it and make it cool again. So how that works is each character, let me see if I can find my skills here. Okay, so each character has command skills, right? He's got Zio, Cleave, Rakukaja, you know all these. But then there's session skills. And session skills. How these work is, hold on, I need to do my Solid Snake voice, so I just need to have some water. Session skills. Nah, it's not working out. So, Lance Slash plus one. A session skill means that if a character uses a lance attack and it is the enemy's weakness, then this character will respond with a combo attack of a slash. Similarly, if an enemy is hit with a wind attack that they are weak to, this character will cast lightning on that character. And it's part of a combo. And the important thing to remember about that is that it doesn't take any resources. It is straight up a free attack. If someone else casts wind, like Tsubasa here, if she casts wind on an enemy and they're weak to it, then Itsuki will go, cool, boom, hit him with lightning. And then if somebody else has an electric session attack, like Kiria here, she will go, oh, he got hit with electricity now, I'm gonna hit him with blizzard. And you get combo attacks out of every different turn. Now, you may be saying, well, what if the enemy drains fire? Then you don't want to have them session into a fire attack. Well, let me see about that, because that's actually something that I've been wondering about. Okay, so that is indeed something that you need to worry about for a single enemy. However, then there's a thing where if you kill an enemy with the first attack of your combo, then it will change targets for the second and third, so you can actually kill multiple enemies with one combo. However, because that's a little bit because you don't know necessarily which enemy they're going to go to, but you do know what the combo is, then you might get into a problem with that, with hitting the next enemy over with something that they reflect or something. However, this passive ability that this character will have forever states that When you perform a session overkill, which means when you kill him with the first hit, and then it switches targets for the second and third hits, those attacks will ignore affinities, so they'll just hit normally. So you can't screw yourself with that, so that's good. Anyway, by the way, if you thought that to yourself, then this is the kind of game for you. You should be playing Shin Megami Tensei games because you clearly have a mind for JRPGs and would do well with them. Alright, so anyway, I would love there to be a map. However, there is a map, but it's on my Wii U gamepad. This game says on the back of the box that you can play it with a Wii Remote and Nunchuck, but I have not figured out a way to actually do that yet. Okay, so these guys are weak to fire and lightning. And this guy, we're not sure yet, so let's hit him with wind. Oh, the signatures! Notice that when she casts a spell... So there's our session attack like I was talking about. Notice when somebody casts a spell, watch in front of her arms. She's gonna cast a spell and it will draw on, like, as her magical, what do you call it? Sigil, or like the rune or something, whatever you would call it, that she draws here, is her signature that you see on the status screen. Oh, that is so cool! Like, just, there's so much attention to detail here. Let's Zio. Well, this guy we know it he's weak to, so... that'll create a nice little session here. Boom, she hits with wind. Because that was wind, she hits with blizzard. And then also, for doing session attacks, you get extra bonuses, like, we'll see here. On the third hit, it'll tell us on kind of the top middle of the screen that for doing a third one, we got 268 yen. So we got money that time. Sometimes you get special items and materials for crafting new equipment and that kind of stuff. All right, we got a couple levels. From what I've heard, here's where some Fire Emblem comes in. I have heard that these level ups are randomized. Just, like, that was a shitty level. I only got one strength and one defense, while I could have gotten more, and it's random. I have heard, like, that was a pretty good level. I've heard that that's random, and that that is something that Fire Emblem fans are familiar with and okay with. I think that is abso-fucking-lutely retarded. So that's something that I really dislike, is the idea of randomized stat gains from levels that can be good or can be bad. Like, so you're asking me, basically what you're asking me to do is save the game when I'm about to level up, and then save scum until I get a good level, which sounds like a pain in the ass and it's stupid. Give me the Shin Megami Tensei style of being able to choose my own levels, you know, or the Persona style of just not randomizing it, because that's dumb. Anyway, that's a gripe I have so far, but anyway, this game is really, really good, as you can see so far. One interesting thing you may be noticing is that all the dialogue, all the voice work is in Japanese. There's no option for that. You can't change it. It's in Japanese. There are no English voices for this game. Now, important stuff is subtitled, or, like, you know, regular day-to-day conversation is, what I mean is, like, all the story stuff has English text boxes, of course, when you talk to people. So, you're not missing any dialogue, it's just there aren't English voices, so you're going to have to read. I like it, because the voices acting is pretty good. There aren't any characters that are annoying yet, so, you know, I'm totally fine with it. Okay, this dungeon has a mechanic where if I walk in front of a camera, I get teleported back to the entrance. Oh, I didn't even see that guy. Now, you may notice the character on the right there, it does not show up in the battles. Well, that is because you can have different costumes on people. That's actually Kiria. But I just have her set to her day-to-day outfit because I like it more. And I'll show you why in a second. Okay, we don't know what this guy is weak to. Let's wind him. You know, give him the old Persona style, try all the things one at a time until something sticks. Uh-oh. Okay, Flux. Okay, good. It doesn't seem to be instant kill like it is in persona, but it does a lot of damage. Alright, let's boofoo this guy, and then that should start a session, which will... Oh, an ad-lib performance! I have not seen these yet! So this is apparently random? Alright, well that was pretty cool. So, yeah. Oh, and then the rest of our session goes. We got a worm force. Awesome. I have not seen those yet. A couple of my characters have those abilities. They're called ad-lib performances, and they're just randomly, I guess, attacks will be more powerful. So that's really cool. Anyway, here's the deal about her costume. So, usually... she is Solid Snake Miku, which is kind of the only character that I'm not super into the design of. Like, she got, like, her butt showing for some reason, and, well, I don't know. There's nothing specifically that I don't like about it. It's just kind of not the best looking, to me, you know. I think that, her form looks really good, but you can also get, you know, you can change everybody's. Here's her school. This is when she's training. This is her casual outfit, you know. So you got the different outfits for everybody. But no matter what you choose, I guess in the battle opening shot, it always shows their normal form, which is kind of annoying, I guess, because it makes it so that if you use another costume, then it creates like this weird confusion of like. It's not the same person. But okay, here's the weird thing about this costume though. And you can decide for yourself whether this is the reason I use the solid punk, but note the size of her boobs right here and then in the dark form. Why do her boobs get smaller? Either that top that she's wearing is like super compressing or she's stuffing here, and I would like to think that it's the former, but I thought that was a little weird too. It's just a little thing that I noticed. You know, I may or may not be looking at these characters' boobs a lot during the talking parts. You know, you can just decide for yourself. But the point is, I thought that was a little weird. So let's fight a couple more battles. And basically what you should be getting out of this, what I hope to be putting forth here, is that this is a video game that you should buy. It's really, really good. And of course, when I say that, I only mean, like, if you think, you know, of course it's up to you. And I was recently saying, I want to say in a video I did recently, I said something about how I never tell people to buy games, which I'm starting to realize was completely false, because I say it a lot. This is a video game, and it's really good, and you should buy it. So, let's flux this guy, because he's weak to it, so as far as I know, it means it should almost always hit him, right? That's kind of how, what was the dark? Oh, shit, what was the dark in Persona? There was Hama, which was light. Dark was... Mudo. Yeah, Mudo. In this game, it's called Flux, I guess. But it's slightly different. It's not exactly Mudo. It is slightly different. I don't actually know how it works yet, because it seems to just hit them for like 90%, unless they're weak to it, in which case it kills them. I don't know. It's real weird. Anyway, it looks like that's going to teleport us back, so we've got some more dungeon crawling to do. Looks like that's our only option, though, so jumping down off that ledge, excuse me, really just gets you that treasure, and then you get teleported back here. Okay, so that's what's down there. That's the entrance to the dungeon. Let's come back up here. Oh, by the way, on the top left there it says 12. It's because I keep getting text messages from the other characters, but they're on my gamepad, and so I don't want to deal with reading them to you guys, because that's the only way that you could know what's happening on them. It's a Wii U thing. This game is only on Wii U, by the way. As far as I know, it's only on Wii U. Which would make sense, because Nintendo is part of the development. But anyway, let me just get this guy. Ooh, I got a play record, which I guess is like achievements. Completely forgot my train of thought there, but that's okay. Flux, the element is listed as body. I'm not positive what the deal with those is yet, but I think these guys are, they're weak to Zio. All right, we're going to do that. We're gonna do a little session attack here. So, one thing I found about this game that is a little weird is that physical attacks seem to be mostly worthless. I mean, not physical skills. Physical skills are great, but your basic physical attack, it doesn't trigger sessions, even if the enemy is weak to it. So, there's like rarely any reason to use it. Oh, here's another passive skill. Resistance boost. Pretty cool. But, yeah, it's something that I find a little weird, is that there's like rarely a good reason to use a physical attack, because they don't trigger sessions, so it's like a waste. Okay, so this thing, it's facing over there. Oh, wait, I was like just here, wasn't I? But then that's where I got teleported, except that I completely missed this item, so I apologize if you saw that and were frustrated at me. But now there's also a way up to go, so we'll probably go up there, see what's up there, and I'll wrap this up pretty soon. But as you guys can see, this game is really good. I've been streaming it. I'm about 10-12 hours in. And, you know, I've been taking my time with it. So maybe if you're playing it at home, you might be a little further along at this point. But, you know, I take my time with RPGs. But yeah, it's absolutely great. I've been really loving it. And most importantly, what I'm getting out of this game is it is a great holdover if you're excited for Persona 5. If you are excited for Persona 5 like I am, then this is the perfect thing to hold you over. Because it's got all the Shin Megami Tensei that you need. It's very much like a sequel directly to Persona 4, in that it's got this whole, like, express yourself, find yourself and express yourself kind of story going on. Especially the way where it's like, oh, this person's been kidnapped, we better go save them. Now we saved them, but they unlocked this power within themselves, and now they're part of your party. You know, like, it's very close to Persona 4 in its story. So, I like that a lot about it, and, it, you know, it's all the more reason to, like I said, hold you over for Persona 5. So this guy, let's see. Yep, let's hit him with this. And that's just about that. The one last thing I want to show you guys before we go is how the crafting system works, which is... I've got a couple things that I can craft here, so we will we'll go to that pretty soon. Looks like we got another level on Kiria. Ooh, and a new skill. I didn't even notice that. Matsuo. Okay, so this is the first time that I actually have to get rid of something. Horse Slayer is pretty good. Let's see. Lower enemies' defenses, raise party's defense. I do like both these skills. I don't want to get rid of regular Zio. I guess I'm going to get rid of Horse Slayer. The difference with what Horse Slayer does is it's like Cleave, so it's a sword attack, but it's always good against horseback type enemies. So it just has more things that things are weak to. I don't use Rakukaja super often though, but sometimes you really need it. Like sometimes it's really good. I probably use Rakunda less often, though. I'm gonna get rid of Rakunda. I probably use that the least often. So, let's do that. Because, you know, I'm not gonna use it on a regular-ass battle. I'm only gonna use it on, like, boss battles and stuff. But a lot of the time, for boss battles, Itsuki is doing, like, a ton of damage because of the way that sessions are set up and that kind of stuff. Anyway, let's go back to what this game's Velvet Room is and do some crafting. So, skills. Tsubasa has a special ability that teleports us right back to the office from anywhere in the world. So once again, here is our special idol office where we all hang out and do our business. And this blue door, it's kind of like a velvet room door a little bit in its special color. But you come in here, this is the, what is it called, the Bloom Palace? And I was talking about how Tiki, is a virtual idol like Miku, but she's also a real thing, a real entity, and it's because she's a Mirage and she hangs out in the Bloom Palace. This is also where the other Mirages hang out. There's Chromu and Kane and Seda and I keep forgetting this one's name. Tharja? Something like that. But let's talk to Tiki. She's adorable. So Carnage is weapons. So Seda, that, oh perfect, that is for Tsubasa. So, oh, and we got new Radiant skills. These are the permanent passive skills. So we got one for Itsuki and one for Toma. Well, we didn't get them yet. We're able to make them. So Carnage, that is your weapon. And the thing about Carnage is you get your new abilities from your weapons. So as you have one equipped, you saw that there were two experience bars, you know, and I was getting new skills separately from getting new levels, and the skills were coming from the weapons. And once you get all four that a weapon has to offer, you've mastered it, and at that point you should change weapons. At the same time, if you get access to a new weapon, you shouldn't necessarily, I'm sorry, I hit my mic, you shouldn't necessarily equip it until you've mastered the previous. So we just mastered Itsuki's, so it's too bad that we don't have a new one to make quite yet. But Tsubasa has been dealing with a mastered Radiant Lance forever, so it's a really good thing that we got a new thing for her. She's gonna learn some good. Ooh, Media! Oh, awesome! That is great. So this thing I'm excited for. So here we go. We're gonna make a new weapon for her. So, Tiki is also basically Igor. I forgot to mention that part. You can skip this, also. I want to show it, but just so you know, you can skip it. Yeah! Yes, please. All right. And then the other thing that we got was new Radiant skills. So these are permanent passive abilities. What did we get? Unyielding Lord. So this will increase evade against Lance Affinity attacks, which sounds really good. I'm not sure if Itsuki is weak to Lances right now. It's a Fire Emblem thing if he is. But this sounds pretty good anyway. Yeah, poses! Except only like three of them. Just show them like seven times even though there's only three. But then Fist Pound! Yeah. I wish I had a badass imaginary friend that would flying fist pound me. Alright. Next up, let's see. She doesn't have any new ones I can get. He does, I know. I'm just checking everybody else. Alright, so looks like Toma also has one. So, ooh, max HP increased by 10. So he'll just get that forever now. And as you can see, yes, you can skip it. Alright. So there we go. That's Tokyo Mirage Sessions Sharp FE! This game is really, really cool. I've been streaming it a lot, and hey, I mean, if you don't have a Wii U, but you think the game looks cool or interesting,
Feel free to stop on by my Twitch channel if you see us in the next few months, because I'll probably be playing a lot.
But other than that, it's a really cool game for the Wii U. You guys should definitely check it out. And thanks very much for watching. I hope you enjoyed. And, Yeah. It's real good. You should buy it.